and tomorrow I return back to California. We thought that what we would do, since, as my brother pointed out, the last month was a short little window that we call Black History Month, the tiny little window that began in 1926 with Carter G. Woodson as Negro History Week and expanded to Black History Month, I think, in 1970. The demand for the information was so strong that by 1970, instead of the 1 week period between the birthdays of Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln, they expanded it to 28 days, 29 days in leap year. And what we are finding, I think what we knew all the time, is that this is the greatest story that's barely been told, and you cannot tell it in a short period of time. And then this month is regarded, I don't know if it's UNESCO or the United Nations or the United States, as Women's History Month. So we thought, since we have this official recognition, that we would combine the best of both worlds and do something on, we're asking everybody to sit on this side, if at all possible, because I can't swivel the chair. So if you sit over here, at least I can have some degree of eye contact, and you can sit in the first row if you like, that we would combine both of those elements. Now, I'm always learning. I realize that. I learn something new every day. And today, maybe it's just something about being in the rarefied air of Boston. As many times as I've done presentations like this, I lost sight of what greatness is. You know, when we say great African women, exactly what does that mean? Now, traditionally, I would say greatness applies to an African queen from ancient Egypt, or a warrior queen like Nzinga from the Congo. But it occurred to me that today, that a woman who is an African woman who is a domestic servant, who spends her whole life cleaning up after white people, who has children to take care of, and who swallows her pride and her dignity, and does what she has to do to make ends meet, isn't she just as great as a woman who inherited the throne of ancient Egypt? So when we say greatness, exactly what are we talking about? And I would tend to think that most great women, African women in particular, their names will never be mentioned in a book. There will never be an article about them. We'll never hear their names on TV. They are those who labored in the vineyards doing what they had to do to keep it together. And so rather than focus on great African individuals, I decided that I would simply show images of African womanhood, African femininity from ancient and modern. Now, some of you might think that it's a contradiction for me as a black man or as a man to do a presentation on African women. Some people might, especially some feminists, might take a degree of resentment about that. I feel just the opposite of that. That as a secure man, a secure black man, a secure African man, that is, and a historian, and I think a pretty good one, that it's, maybe it says even more that we're able to pay tribute to our sisters, our mothers, our daughters, our wives, etc. So today's presentation, I'm not sure what it's called on the flyer, but will be images of African women, ancient and modern. And when I say African, I'm using the word African and black interchangeably. I come from the old school, the Peter Tosh school of thought that says no matter where you come from, as long as you're a black man, you're an African. And beyond that, humanity began in Africa. There's only one race, and that's the human race, which has an African origin. So I'm hoping that this is a presentation that will appeal to all of us. Now, all I'm gonna do and sit in this chair, dry off from the rain, and click these this external mouse and just show you some pictures. I wish that I was in a situation where I could sit at the front desk and look at you and look at the screen at the same time, but I'm not able to do that. So I'm looking forward to being able to turn the lights off completely so that you will be able to focus just on the screen and not the back of my head. Now, this is an image, and as this side fills up, you all go ahead and sit on this side. But I was asking everybody to sit over here so at least I could swivel around from time to time and see what you all look like and make sure that nobody's snoring back there. Please turn your cell phones off. There's no digital photography of any kind. A lot of these images don't belong to me. A lot of them have never been published in any book anywhere, so I can't, in good conscience, allow you to record it. Jamal's my brother, but in addition to that, Jamal works so hard in the community that I've given him I've made an exception and allowed him to record this. There are some DVDs and books and things at the front desk if you're so inclined. I know people in Boston have a lot of money, and so it probably won't hurt you to plunk down $20 or $40 for a couple of DVDs. I do not expect, and I say that because we need your support, I do not expect when I get back to Los Angeles tomorrow to go to my P.O. box and open it up and find a check for $50,000 from Bill Gates saying, Renoco, you're doing a wonderful job destroying white supremacy, and I thought this might help you out a little bit. So if you could purchase something, that would be great. Even if you can't, there are flyers up there with my contact information about my tours, educational materials, and what have you. Now the images, because I wanted to make it very informal, are not in any particular order. They are at random. So I might go from one image to the next. It might be ancient, modern, past, present, but it's all connected to this universal theme of great black women, great African women, images of African women, womanhood, images of African or black femininity. So we all together. Yes?
Yes.
How's everybody tonight?
Great.
Well, I've enjoyed my stay in Boston. I got here about 3 o'clock in the morning. I went to the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, took a lot of pictures, staying in a nice hotel. And I like this weather, especially when you don't have to get out in it. So let's hit the show on the road. Now these images right here are brand new. I've never seen this in a book. And these are from Thailand. And the brother who sent me these, this is a student of mine, working on his doctorate degree in at a university in Bangkok, very interested in the black presence in Southeast Asia, photographed these and sent me a copy of it. These are Buddhist good luck dolls. Now, if you didn't know any better, you might think, if you didn't see that script up there, that this was like African-American, what do you call it, memorabilia, like lawn jockeys and stuff. But these are Buddhist good luck dolls. They're very small. They each have different names, and to me, they're fascinating. I don't know how old they are, but Buddhism is a very ancient religion, and I don't see any reason to think that these are not ancient as well. This one takes us to Kemet, where Brother Neil and I traveled together. This is an image of a black woman named Amos Nefertari, a little bitty sister, I'm told, that had thinning hair and buck teeth. Stood about 5 feet tall, and she is one of the most beloved figures in ancient times. She lived about 3,600 years ago. She is one of the co-founders of the dynasty, the African family, which is called the 18th dynasty. Her husband's name is Amos the First, and her name is Amos Nefertari. She is painted black. Now, the ancient Egyptians were black people. Every now and then, there was a foreign invasion. The people called the Hyksos, the Assyrians, I should say the Persians. But for the most part, the people of ancient Egypt were indigenous to Africa. They were, in fact, black people. Egypt is, after all, in Africa. And to my knowledge, it has always been in Africa. I was there last September, and it was for the 20th time, and Egypt was in Africa at that time. And I have not heard a blurb, a soundbite on CNN saying, news, Egypt has moved to another continent. It's always been in Africa, and the people who built ancient Egyptian civilization were African. Now, some of y'all, like Brother Jamal here, my esteemed brother, are probably more activists than they are historians. Everybody doesn't have the time to sit in a library or be on the internet 24/7 reading books, doing research, traveling halfway around the world. And sometimes activists, they say later for all that historical stuff. You know, black people got so many problems that we don't have the time, we don't have the luxury to study history. Well, I would disagree with that. I think that there has to be a balance, that we must be thinkers and doers, that you can't just be an activist without any kind of guidance. But you also can't live in the past. You can't live in the fourth dynasty on the Giza Plateau when we build pyramids. My philosophy of history is this, and this is what it's all about. It's very important that you understand where I'm coming from, because this will set the tone for the rest of the presentation, which we're gonna have to move on because we only have a limited amount of time. But it's important to build a foundation, and it goes like this. What you do for yourself depends on what you think of yourself. And what you think of yourself depends on what you know of yourself. And what you know of yourself depends on what you have been told. So if you've been told all your life that you come from the jungle, that you don't have a history, then no wonder we act the way we do. No wonder the N-word rolls so easily off our tongues. No wonder your best friend is your dog. No wonder the B-word comes out of your mouth so easily because you don't know any better. And I know that's a put down. But people who know their history do not demean themselves with language of that type. Only people who are told that happened a long time ago, it's irrelevant, forget about it, get over it, talk like that about one another. You will never hear a Jewish person that I'm aware of say, the Holocaust was a long time ago, let's forget about it. They not only tell you about it, but they cram it down your throat. There's not a day that goes by, there's not some recollection of what happened to people in Nazi Germany. And I don't blame them for that. But at the same time, people can't say, that's important, that's sacred, the world needs to know, never forget, and tell you that your history happened a long time ago, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, get over it. You can't have it, thank you very much, you can't have it both ways. So we think history is very important. We think history is not dead and the past is not finished. So we try to combine elements of the ancient and the modern. This is Amos Nefertari. She's painted black. Now, the ancient Egyptians themselves were black, but black is also symbolic. What did it symbolize? In ancient Egypt, indeed, black was considered the color of God. It was considered the color of divinity. It was a holy color. So let's move on. Now, this is a sister. I don't know her name. A lot of the people I'm going to show you, I don't know their names. This is an African woman from Suriname in South America. Okay, Suriname is the only Dutch colony in South America. And one of the things about Suriname, the Dutch were very brutal enslavers, and they were brutal colonizers. And you, as a result of that, you had resistance leaders and people who ran away from the plantations and the haciendas, and they're called Maroons. And this is a Maroon sister from Suriname, South America. This is the famous writer, Zora Neale Hurston, who I understand Langston Hughes fell in love with. She did a lot of research on Bodoun. I just got back from Haiti. I was there just before the earthquake. And unfortunately, this sister died in obscurity. And it was Alice Walker who more or less resurrected our knowledge of Zora Neale Hurston. She was very active in the 20s and 30s. This is a sister that if she wasn't hooked up with the president, I would like to talk to her. This is Michelle Obama. Now I want to warn you, I'm a big admirer of the Obamas. So if you got anything bad to say about them, please don't say it around me. I love to see a black man and a black woman together. Now they may be working for the most imperialistic government the world has ever seen, but they're still African and I admire them. I go out of my way not to talk about black folk in public. Now, what Jamal and I talk about in private is our business. But I'm not going to get at a public forum and talk about anybody, not even Clarence Thomas. Where's she from? Who can tell me? Should be easy. India. Yeah. Now, one of the telltale signs, of course, is that dot on her forehead. But if you didn't see that, chances are you would not have a clue, although Somalia was a good guess, about where she's from. Now, I only brought about 3,000 or 4,000 pictures with me on my hard drive. And tonight, I'm going to try to show you about 120, maybe 140. If you really like it, we'll find somewhere out in the rain and show you a couple thousand more from Cambodia. Now, while I do this, you can also play the game called Who That Is. And not who is that, who that is. And the way you play Who That Is, that's when I show you somebody that looks like somebody you know, you're supposed to say who that is. Now, this is an apsara, kind of like a Buddhist version of an angel in Cambodia. This is about 800 years old. This sister, I think her name is Mary Shad Carey. I always get her name mixed up. She lived in the early to mid-1800s, and she is the first black woman to, I think, publish a newspaper in North America. She couldn't do it in the United States, so she had to go to Canada. So African Canadians take a lot of pride in this sister right here. From where? Close, very close. Malaysia. Right at the border between northern Malaysia and southern Thailand. And that's an Afro that we all would have been proud of back in the day. Right? Malaysia. Obviously, this one's from Egypt. And this is in the Brooklyn. Yeah, you all did come out tonight. Bless your heart. In the rain. And nobody melted. This one obviously is from Kemet. And let's give our brother Jamal a big, big, big round of applause. Not just for organizing this program, but for all the work he's done. and all the work that we expect he's going to do. We're very proud of you, my brother. Now, this one is from Egypt. This is from the end of the Pyramid Age. And this shows the importance of the African woman in ancient Egyptian or Kemite history. This piece takes us back to about 4,200 years ago, about 2,200 years BC from the 6th dynasty. This is in the Brooklyn Museum of Fine Arts. Here, this statue is made of alabaster. Her name is Ahmes Pepi II, and her son's name is Pepi II. This little boy became the king of Egypt when he was 10. He died on the throne at the tender age of 104. He had a 94-year reign. Now, in ancient Egypt, the line of descent is traced to the female side of the family. It is the woman who the emphasis is placed on. The worst thing you could do in ancient Egypt was to disrespect your mother. You didn't use the B word back then. And there's not a single record, not a single incident that I'm aware of in the whole history of ancient Egypt where a woman was sexually assaulted, not in thousands of years. So you can judge a civilization not just by the great buildings that were erected, not by the arts and sciences alone, but by the morality, by the stature of the women. There's no prisons in ancient Egypt. There are no convalescent homes in ancient Egypt. There were no foster homes then. So you can also judge a civilization based on the sense of morality and respect for women and family. Brother, if you're out of seats over there, come sit over here. Well, that's all right. You're already late. You're already looking good. And now, it's dark, so y'all can make yourselves comfortable and sit where you want to. So spread out. You know, black people like space. From Bangladesh. So we're also giving a kind of a geography lesson. You know that African people are scattered all over the world. Humanity began in Africa. Nepal, India, and India. Now she looks like she could be Somali to me, or Ethiopian, or Eritrean. She's from a community called the Bil, B-H-I-L, and these are the tribal people of South, East, and Central India. Look, all from East India, and she's from the state of Orissa. Now, some people might take that name Orissa and really run with it, and it may be a linguistic connection. From Ghana, I took this picture last summer, last July. One of the things I like about the Ghanaian school system is they make the girls keep their hair cut short until they're about 14 or 15. So they don't have this thing about hair. You don't see people with long weaves and stuff in the schools. There's not a sense of competition there. I like that. You know, they come to school to learn and not to compete. They don't come to see who has the nicest pair of Nikes, who has the longest fingernails. And when you go to school in Ghana, you don't have to worry about getting shot. When I teach school there, I never have to tell the students to sit up, be quiet, pay attention. Don't you want to learn something? Because they see school as an opportunity. We see it as an entitlement. Now, the sad part about it is when they graduate from school, you see there's no job for them. So the best and brightest of them leave if they can and come to the United States and Canada and Europe. And thus, the people who are needed the most to develop the country more often than not are not there because of economic conditions. Morocco, these are Berber women. And you can see the Berbers, known by the Europeans as Moors, cover a wide spectrum. You can see several different ethnic or racial types here. This sister was clearly the most dominant. She was the one who asked me for the money when I took the picture. Morocco. From India, a tribal woman. Not only looks defiant, but also rather sexy, if I might say so. From where? China.
Oh, that's that sister.
That's that sister.
The problems, right?
With the African American father and the Chinese mother, who won, I think, a beauty contest or was on a reality TV show, and got such a backlash that it really shook her. She went on to say that she had no idea that the Chinese had such an anti-African or anti-black mentality. This is the Black Virgin of Paris. This is one of the Black Madonna statues. Probably the most sacred icon in Paris. She's got the French colors, the red, white, and blue. I guess the United States took theirs from there. The scepter, or the wand, which is a symbol of French sovereignty. And They have blonde hair, but at least it's frizzy. And you can see, you know, they're painted black. From London, this is the statue atop the entrance to Westminster Abbey Cathedral. She's from Southern Africa. She was a martyr. And for whatever reason, they put a statue of her at Westminster Abbey Cathedral. She looks like Angela Bassett. Back in Cambodia, this one is a cameo. I got this postcard in Vienna, Austria. This is a sculpture by a French artist named Charles Goggier.
Oprah.
Yeah.
You think so?
Yeah.
Y'all been in the rain too long. Oprah. Maybe I should send it to Oprah and she'll have me on the show. Now, Goggier was a Frenchman, and he was a great artist, but he believed Africans should be portrayed with dignity. And he did a series of these about 1868, 1869. That's a beautiful piece of art. And it's in the Musée d'Orsay in Paris. Kerouamama from the 20th dynasty, about 3,000 years ago in Egypt. Now this is in one of the queens in the mummy room, one of the mummy rooms in the Cairo Museum. Neil, did we see this when we were over there?
No.
All right. I think that room has just opened up within the last 3 or 4 years. And in this room, you have the remains of African royalty, particularly from the later dynastic periods. And there's about 3 or 4 of them that look almost like they could come out of that glass case. And there's a look of dismay I find on her face. Now, the last thing these folk would have wanted was for people to put them on display and come and gawk at them and laugh and poke at them. But at least you can see the African characteristics. Look at that hair. Now, the eyes are artificial. I think they've been added relatively recently, but the rest of it is authentic.
Wow.
Nefertiti. Queen Tai, this is the mother of Akhenaten and I believe Tutankhamun as well. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. A man, a sister, and a brother together, very much in love. You won't see that in Greco-Roman art. You almost never see a man and a woman portrayed together in Greco-Roman art. I've had sisters tell me, and you brothers have had the same experience, I'm sure. Sisters say, well, I don't really want to get too close. I don't want to be intimate. Let's have a platonic relationship. What does that mean? It comes from the words of Plato. Plato believed that the ideal relationship was for an older man and a young boy. Sister, are they going to be able to, can y'all see behind the sisters nice? Cast out. Sis, I think you might want to move around. Yes, please, please. This brother just came in and he's the operations manager for the lecture. I appreciate it. But they look like they belong together. But you won't see this in Greece and Rome.
I'm sorry, you were going into Plato?
Plato?
Yeah.
Plato believed that the ideal relationship was for an older man and a young boy. Plato thought that an intimate relationship between a man and a woman, a romantic relationship between a man and a woman, was a form of insanity. He thought that people must be crazy for a man and a woman to fall in love. That didn't make sense to him. So when we use these terms, we might want to investigate as to really what we're saying. And I don't think there are many of us who in this room desire a platonic relationship based on what I just explained. Again, this is from the tombs of the nobles in ancient Egypt about 3,000 years ago. That's a beautiful piece. Very dignified. Again, the remains of an African queen who's been mummified, unwrapped, and photographed. Again, look at the hair. It looked like your hair, sis. Showed you this one earlier. Look at that hairstyle. These are all from Egypt. I love that right there. Look, even if you disagree with everything I said, which is highly possible, you can't say that these are not beautiful pieces of art, at the very least. Now, is she beautiful?
Yes.
Now, a lot of people would not say that. I wouldn't show this in an average public school to African children. Because many of them would say, she's so ugly, she's so black. What's wrong with her? And they would laugh and call her names. Because our definition and concept of beauty, for the most part, is given to us by the same people who oppressed and enslaved us. So light skin, for most of us, is the hallmark of beauty in the black community.
Right.
Look at the role models we have. Mariah Carey, Beyonce, Tyra Banks. And I see it in Africa now, with sisters bleaching their skin with these long, blonde weaves. I'd be glad when that style is finished. With blue contact lenses in their eyes. In countries where the people are naturally almost blue-black, that they have developed the idea that the standard of beauty is not them. And so you alter your physical appearance and you become something of a monstrosity, a freak, to fit other people's standards of beauty. And sisters tell me the reason we do that is because that way we feel like we have a better chance of getting a man. Because they think that's what the brother is looking for. Now we have lots of work to do. The essence of power, it has been said, is the ability to define someone's reality and make them live according to that definition as though it is a definition of their own choosing. I repeat, the essence of power is the ability to define someone's reality and make them live according to that definition as though it is a definition of their own choosing. So other people have defined for us what it means. The essence of power is the ability to define someone's reality and make them live according to that definition as though it is a definition of their own choosing. Now, what does that mean? What is that? How does that translate practically? That other people give us a sense, their sense of what it means to be successful. What is success? Getting a job, making a lot of money? If it's just about money, go sell drugs. If it's just about money, it has to be more than that. What does it mean to be happy? Does being happy mean being married to somebody who doesn't look like you, living in a community where you really stand out? What is happiness? Or is happiness being a good mother, a good father, lifting your community up, finding a cure for cancer, finding a cure for AIDS? What is happiness? What is success? But what is beauty is very, very important. Because we are ingrained with this mentality that white is right and yellow is mellow. And if you're red, go ahead. And if you're brown, stick around. But if you're black, get back. That's why I ask, is she beautiful? And if so, why is she beautiful? All right, let's think on that. I notice it's very quiet in the room. This is an image from Kemet again. The word Kemet means the black city or the black community. And that's what we call ancient Egypt. And this is an aspect of God called Sheshat. You can always recognize her because she has a star of Sirius over her head. And she is identified as the world's first librarian. She is called the mistress of the house of books. Isis, or Aset. The word Aset means the throne. The Greeks call her Isis. And you can always tell her as an African woman with a throne on top of her head. And she was a magician. In times of danger, she could grow wings and fly. This is the wife of Osiris or Asar. Uh-oh, that one's not. Maybe I took that picture in a hurry. Maybe I had to bribe somebody. This is just some sisters with nice locks in ancient Egypt. Now here's a good one. This is Queen Charlotte Sophia. She supposedly had Moorish blood in her veins. Moors were Africans who come out of Northwest Africa. And she is the wife of King George III during the time of the American Revolution. She had 15 children. She is an ancestor, a grandmother, a great-grandmother, I think, of Queen Victoria. So when you talk about Victoria's Secret or Victoria's Secrets, you could easily put her at the top of the list. Okay? Queen Charlotte Sophia, the city of Charlotte, North Carolina, is named after her. I took this picture in the National Portrait Gallery in London. This one is from ancient Kemet again. This is a sister named Amenhotep. Here she is here and there, and she is probably the most powerful woman of her time. She lived about 2,700 years ago. A picture I took in Bolivia. This woman is called the Queen of the Afro-Bolivianos. She and her husband are cocoa farmers. Hatshepsut from ancient Egypt.
How big is that?
What's that right there?
Yeah.
It's the Sphinx. I guess it's about 4 feet high, but it's on a kind of a platform, so it's kind of hard to tell. But about 4 feet high, and it's made of pink granite. This is an image of an African woman with a pendant, or I guess you call it a pendant, of an aspect of God called Heheru or Hathor. I took this in a museum in Budapest, Hungary, a couple of years ago. I've been to 96 countries now, election in 52. This is an image of an Ethiopian princess in Lima, outside of Lima, Peru. And she's popular in Peru among all people because she supposedly was a heathen, was a pagan, and she found Christianity and converted. And Peru is such a strong Catholic country that she is more or less venerated. A black Madonna and child in Budapest, Hungary. Another image of an ancient female, I think a black woman. This is about 25,000 years old. This is from Central Europe. Now here's an interesting one. These are two women on birthing stools from a medical temple in Egypt at a place called Kanambo. And this is how they gave birth in ancient Egypt. You sit on a stool, and I guess that's an image of Aset right there. Remember I talked about the throne? The name Aset means the throne. The Greeks call it Isis. I guess the law of gravity will cause the baby to come out. Seems simpler than.
Is that Upper or Lower Egypt?
Upper Egypt. It's at the border between Upper Egypt and Nubia, Kanambo. This is a sister who, a little bitty sister, who owns a restaurant in El Carmen in Peru, one of the African success stories there. She's got that smile just glued on her face. Every time I see her, she's got that same smile. Another image I photographed in an African office in Lima, Peru. And these are little girls from Lima that I was supposed to lecture to about 2 years ago, and I just didn't want to lecture that day. And they didn't want to lecture, I'm sure. So we just talked. And I said, what is it like for black people in Peru? He said, it's very hard, sir. People make fun of us, they laugh at us, they call us names, they tease us because we are black. Our parents can't find good jobs. And I said, well, you know, do you regret being black? One of the children jumped up and said, no. I think being black is a gift from God. It was a wonderful morning for that day. From Northern Australia, reminds me of Venus Williams. And she is undergoing a rites of passage. Aboriginal people have been treated pretty badly too. We'll spend some time with that as we go along. There's another image of the statue I just showed you a moment ago. Here I am in southern Ecuador with this little feisty sister. I mean, when I say feisty, I mean that, tough. She saw me from a distance and she saw my camera and she asked me, you want to take my picture? I said, yeah, of course I do. As soon as I took it, she put her hand out and she said, now give me some money. And she cursed a lot. She cursed so much, she really made me blush. And I speak the language well, and I understand the language, but that sister had a mouth that would make a sailor say, wait a minute now. The last thing she said was, screw George Bush, but she didn't say screw. She used another four-letter word as she walked away.
Kind of priestess or something?
Yes, you could see that with all the necklaces.
Mm-hmm. It looked like y'all could be relatives.
Yeah.
You think so?
Yeah.
Nobody said that before, but I take that with pride. Here I am with another sister in the North Yungas or South Yungas Mountains in Bolivia. Little girl that I've come to know, I take people to her school and her community, and we give away lots of school supplies when I take groups down there. So when she sees me, she just has a big smile on her face. Also in Peru. I bet you didn't know there were a lot of black folk in some of these places. Bolivia, Peru, Ecuador. Ah, this is my daughter. She's 4.5 years old now. This is my mother, who's an ancestor. An artist in Atlanta put this together. She lives right outside of Paris. Her mother is of Senegalese origin. This is an African scientist with the remains of Dinknesh. These bones were found in 1974. They were regarded at the time as our oldest known ancestor.
That brother kind of looks like Kwame Ture.
Think so?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
You all have a different perspective in Boston.
It's the water.
It's the water, yeah. This is the wife of Amenhotep II. This is one I've never seen before. Very well preserved. and this is in the Petrie Museum in London. Queen Tai made a faience. This is in the Louvre in Paris. Here she is again. Again. This is the wife of Amenhotep III, the mother of Akhenaten and Tutankhamun. This is the most famous one of her. Now, this is what women in ancient Egypt look like. Take a good look, because you're not going to see it on the Discovery Channel. And there they are together. That's her and her man. She looks taller than him. I'm having to get used to that these days in relationships sometimes. Look at one of the children. So a true family portrait. This is maybe the most powerful monarch in the whole of ancient Egypt. This is Amenhotep the Magnificent. There was a big statue of him, a head of him, found in Luxor, Egypt about 3 weeks ago. He reigned for 38 years. This is Tutankhamun's and Akhenaten's daddy. Nefertiti and one of the daughters. Nefertari, wife of Ramses the Great. Who is this? Cleopatra.
Pardon me, can we take a pause for the cause and just let some of these people in?
Yeah, let's take a pause for the cause. Watch the cord there.
Watch the cord.
Thank you, sir.
That's all right. How are you all doing?
All right.
Well, I'm shocked. We got people to come up. A Monday night, no less.
Monday night.
Rainy.
Yeah. Boss is not so bad after all.
Hold tight on that. Don't go too far.
I think I might have gone that too carried away. Like you say, it's the water.
This is an anomaly.
Yeah, no, this is clear, and it's a reflection of your hard work, too, my brother.
And yours.
Well, don't go too far. Now, this is Cleopatra the Seventh. There are at least seven women with that name. And she is the last representative of what is called the Ptolemaic dynasty. And she reigned from about 51 BC to about 30 BC when she committed suicide. Now, everything I've been able to gather says she wasn't really a beautiful person physically. I guess beauty's in the eye of the beholder. But she spoke many languages, very, very intellectual, a leader, a great charisma. And she committed suicide, and at that time, Rome absorbs Egypt into the Roman Empire. A couple months ago, they dug up another tomb in Egypt of Cleopatra's mother and found she was an African woman. Because up to that point, there was a strong discussion. People said, Renoka, was she Greek? Was she Roman? Was she white? Was she black? Was she Egyptian? What was she? Well, I subscribe to the one drop rule, the you is or you ain't rule. And if her mother was African, then that says a lot about her. From Morocco, another Berber from, I love these folk. Neil, you're gonna have to come with me to Morocco, man. This is in the south. For them, silver is a big deal, not so much gold. India, now this looks just like my mother in her later years. Of course, my mother didn't have earlobes like that. You can see how they've been weighted down by that gold. But the silver hair, all of that, that's my mother. India. Now, I love this one. And a lot of these are sent to me from people from India who want me to share with the sisters and brothers in the United States that there are black people in that part of the world, too. And this is just a lovely picture. I love the blue background, but just a nice photo. Don't you like that?
Are these people Dalit? Is that the...
They're tribal people.
Okay.
They're treated like untouchables, but not quite. This is a lithograph of the famous Anne Nzinga, Queen of Congo, Angola. This was done by a Frenchman in 1820. And Nzinga was one of the great freedom fighters in African history. She fought the Portuguese for the last 40 years of her life as they were trying to expand the enslavement of African people. I'm sure that's not what she looked like. But I guess at the time, that was considered the standard of beauty for African women. You know, because I'm sure Nzinga didn't have a jerry curl. Now this is Calafia. Calafia, a depiction of Calafia. This is who California is supposed to be named after, according to the Spanish. You can see the nice little locks. An artist depiction of Calafia, C-A-L-A-F-I-A. Honorary looking picture of Harriet Tubman, who said, I rescued hundreds of my people from slavery, and I could have rescued hundreds more if only they had known that they were slaves. That rings true today. from Northern Australia. Now here's a good one. This one is from Southern Ecuador, from the colonial period. And this is this African woman, fine sister, giving some fruit to this milky white woman and looking at her as if to say, damn, I didn't put enough poison in that fruit. This lady supposed to be dead. I have to do better the next time. That's how I interpret this picture. I have the right to interpret it as I see it. Bessie Coleman, who was a black aviatrix, and unfortunately died in a plane crash in the 1928, I think. This sister's name is Da Silva. She was a big-time African politician in Brazil. And this is from Suriname. I talked about Suriname earlier, that the Dutch were very harsh. And this is something called arsing or assing. And they would take a rebellious black woman and string her up, beat her, strip her, humiliate her, make all the other enslaved Africans come and watch, and then stuff her body with gunpowder and blow her up in front of everybody. That was to serve as an example as to what happens to people who run away or who foment insurrection. This is a black one. This is my favorite, maybe because I took this picture in Switzerland about a year ago. This is magnificent. And this is a depiction of the Virgin Mary and the infant Jesus. But they are black, and the black Madonnas and child are the superstars of the cult of Mary. She is called Our Lady of the Forest, Our Lady of the Hermits, Our Lady of the Dark Wood. And she supposedly is able to perform miracles. Now, Carl Jung, who was a disciple of Sigmund Freud, who some of my friends delight in calling Sigmund Fraud, simply said, this is Isis and Horus. Shirley Graham Du Bois and W.B. Du Bois, a little girl from Bolivia, and Orisha, photographed this in Salvador Bahia, Brazil. This sister is named One Titty. And they call it, it's a bronze statue in Dutch St. Martin. And they call her that because she was a freedom fighter, and to make an example of her, the Dutch cut one of her breasts off to make an example of her, thus that name. This is Sister Sharcy McIntyre. We spent a lot of time in New York, and she wrote a book called Criminalizing a Race. And Sharcy was just a good sister, not only a great scholar, but just good people. Ida B. Wells Barnett. Brother, I don't know if you're going to block folk or not. I think you might want to take your time and just be careful. Ida B. Wells Barnett was a journalist and a teacher, and she reported on the numerous cases of atrocities, terrorism committed against the lynchings, the burning alive, castrations of black folk in the early part of the 20th century. She knew Du Bois, she knew Garvey, but yet she was very feminine. You know, she was an activist, very feminine. She had six children. Yet she referred to her husband in public as Mr. Barnett. But to show you how liberated she was, she called, I think, her oldest daughter Ida B. Wells Jr. A little petite sister, Ida B., a crusader for justice. This is Mary Ellen Pleasant. Now, for most of us who have a favorite white man, it's usually John Brown. If you have a favorite European, or a few of them, usually John Brown is close to the top. Now, I don't know if John Brown believed in the equality of black and white. I don't know, maybe that's not important, but he believed that slavery was an abomination. He was willing to fight and die for his beliefs, so I've got to respect that. But this is the one, and in 1859, he launched a raid on Harper's Ferry, Virginia, which was probably the single most important event that led to the Civil War. And this is the woman who gave him the money for that. It is said in 1859, she gave John Brown $30,000 in 1859. That's the story. She was a businesswoman. Now that's a nice piece of change right now. But in 1859, that was a phenomenal sum of money. That's the story. And we should know about her. We should celebrate her.
$1 million.
More than that, I think. I wish somebody would give me 30 grand. 3 grand. 300. I'll be 100 there. This is Queen Mother Moore, a reparations activist and also a Garveyite. a true, a regal woman right there. She lived to be almost 100. This is from the school of art called Orientalism. This was a big school of art in Europe around the late 1800s. And again, it showed people, including a lot of black people, from what was called the Orient. And they're always portrayed in a very dignified fashion, not buffoons, not clowns, not minstrels. Amy Ashwood Garvey, which is the first wife of Marcus Mosiah Garvey. His second wife was named Amy, too. So you have Amy Ashwood Garvey, and then Amy Jakes Garvey. So I don't know if he just likes sisters named Amy, what, but this powerful sister, and this is from a cover of a book by the Garveyite scholar, who you should know from this area, Tony Martin.
Y'all know Professor Tony Martin?
Yeah. Oh, you should know. These should be household words. If you know Snoop Dogg and Jay-Z and Beyonce, you should know them. If you know Kobe and Kevin Garnett, you should know these folks. Now, this is Graceland Smallwood, and this is a brother, Aboriginal brother, a mayor of a city, an Aboriginal city in northern Queensland called Yarrabah. And Graceland Smallwood is a sister I think of as the queen of Aboriginal Australians. Powerful woman right there, who's really a Jamal's contemporary in Australia, a freedom fighter. And whenever there's an issue, she's on the front line. And Grace is a buddy of mine, she's a pal of mine, and when I go to Australia, if I don't see her, then something ain't right. Here we are in an Aboriginal community giving the Black Power salute. And these are the colors. Black for the people, gold for the sun, you see the clenched fist, and red for the land, because they say the land is covered with their blood. Do you know black people in Australia were not considered human until January 1967 by the government? I repeat, until the beginning of January 1967, what is that, 43 years ago? Am I right? Yeah. Black people in Australia were considered plants and animals. They were officially classified as flora and fauna. Today, black people make up about 3% of the total population, and yet black folk make up about, black men make up about 80% of the prison population. If you're an Aboriginal Australian, you can be jailed for stealing a pencil, stealing a biscuit. That sound familiar? But even more extreme than the justice system in the good old US of A. This is Drusilla Dungy Houston, a great African-American historian who in 1926 wrote a book called Wonderful Ethiopians in the Ancient Kushite Empire. And she also covered the destruction of Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma, I think in 1921. A sister that I met in, I started to say Aboriginal community. Actually a community called the Garigano, a people called the Garigano, Garifuna, and Honduras. She lived in a community that I lectured in called Sambo Creek, Honduras. I think this is a painting by Jacob Lawrence. I just like that. You know Jacob Lawrence's work? Yeah. Lucia. This is what scientists say the first human being in the Americas looked like, anywhere from 12 to 30,000 years ago. A skull was found in Brazil, and a reconstruction was done by BBC, and they say this is what she looked like. The only debate is whether she was a continental African or she was Aboriginal Australian. A sister from the Philippines. A photograph I took of a sister in Northern Australia. These are the most spiritual people I've ever encountered. And there's a spiritual aura about her. I mean, these are very interesting folk. And here I am in Northern Australia in a town called Townsville at the University of, I think it's the University of Northern Queensland. And here I am with two sisters. Jamal, you would be very interested to know. These are two of the founding members, of the original founding members, of the Aboriginal Australian Black Panther Party. In 1975, they formed a branch of the Black Panthers in Brisbane, Australia. And I gave a lecture for an African freedom fighter over there who was being railroaded, and they came to the lecture. It was a great honor, and we hung out a little bit and took this nice photo opportunity. And I like this because not only it's historic, but this gives me the, this gives people the impression that Renoko is trying to be very health conscious. Yeah. I'm trying to stay out of those fast food places. I'm trying to, it's hard. From Buka Island in Papua New Guinea. They say they come from Africa. And they're the blackest, they have the reputation, I don't know things quite justified of being the blackest human beings in the world. but they're pretty dark. From New Zealand. If you didn't know better, you might think she was Native American. But she's fondly Maori. Certainly you've heard of the Maori or the Maori.
Hawaii.
Hawaii?
Hawaii. There's a famous little reality celebrity that this looks like. Did y'all ever see that Real World with the Hawaiian girl who was really kind of crazy?
Yeah. Oh,
interesting. Exactly.
All right. This is an old Olmec head from Mexico next to a sister from Chicago. I say that one of the great crimes you can commit is to teach a child that their history began with slavery. Let me pick up the pace because we're quickly running out of time. Of course, this is a story we could go on, talk about indefinitely. Ancient Egypt, Congo. I mean, you can see the comparison.
Wow.
From the Amarna period in ancient Egypt, the period of Akhenaten and Nefertiti, Congo. Brother Renoko with the sister from Colombia. Now, I've been told, again, it looks like we could be relatives.
Yeah. She looks like the actress Esther Rowe.
She do.
I never heard a lot of this one. I may have to come back to Boston and spend some time. Nanny of the Jamaican Maroons, a great resistance leader from Jamaica. Actually from Ghana, but lived in Jamaica. From Haiti. Now that's a powerful picture, isn't it? Sojourner Truth, who when white women were struggling for the right to vote and leaving black folk out, she is said to have uttered the immortal words, "Ain't I a woman too?" Pauline Elizabeth Hopkins, who was born in this area. She was actually born in Portland, Maine in 1859. Yeah, y'all come on across, just be careful of the cord. Well, this is remarkable. Now, Pauline Elizabeth Hopkins was a writer, and she died in obscurity in Brooklyn, New York in 1930. She was burned to death in a fire. Another image called the Lady Rye. This is from ancient Egypt. You can see the hair. A sister that I met in Turkey. Here I am with three sisters in Turkey. I bet you didn't know black folk lived in Turkey. This is an artist depiction, a Dutch artist depiction of Zipporah, the wife of Moses. Sister from Oman in the Persian Gulf.
It's Kiki Breedwell. It's Kiki.
Yep, sure enough. Sure enough it does.
From Yemen in the Persian Gulf. Or Yemen is not in the Persian Gulf. Yemen is in Southwest Arabia. An African Palestinian who was a law student at Howard University for a while. A black untouchable in India. Look at the back-breaking work that they're engaged in. Brother Jamal referred to these folk as Dalits. The word Dalit means crushed, broken, and oppressed. But we sometimes call them untouchables because they are taught or outcast, that their touch is considered polluting and they're outside the caste system. A soul sister from ancient Pakistan. Just look at that hand on her head. India. A black woman in a Turkish harem. A sister thrown down in a Turkish harem. From Fiji, now it's my turn. She looks like a combination of Jill Scott and Aretha Franklin. From Eritrea in the Horn of Africa. A lot of Eritreans in Boston, apparently. I had an Eritrean taxi driver today. Very friendly brother. From ancient Carthage, Hawaii, Fiji. Now, I fell in love with this sister. I can fall in love in about 2 to 3 minutes if the situation is right. And I went to her village, and I ended up with a bunch of European tourists, quite to my dismay. And what got me was, what pushed me over the edge was, she looked at all these white folks and says, you know, we come from Africa. We speak an African language. And we used to eat a lot of white people. But we had to stop because the meat was bad. Now, I don't think she was really serious, but to me it was, I just wanted to get out of my knee and say, sister, will you marry me? So I saw a ring on her finger and I said, okay, you get away. Now, here's a very important woman. This is Truganini, the last full-blood Tasmanian. whose life was one of the constant victim of brutality. There really is a place called Tasmania, and I've been there. Look at this one. Naturally frizzy blonde hair from New Britain, East New Britain in Papua New Guinea. I took that picture about a year and a half ago. My mother, when she was a youngster. I have so much respect for black women, including my own family members. To me, any black man that doesn't have great respect for black women, you've got a real problem. It was Alexander Dumas. Alexander Dumas himself, whose grandmother was born in Haiti, who identified himself as a Negro, the man who wrote the book, The Three Musketeers, The Count of Monte Cristo, The Man in the Iron Mask, who said, a man's mind is elevated to the status of the women with whom he associates. It is Phyllis Hyman. And I would have loved to have seen this sister perform. A voice like an angel, or to me, what I think an angel sounded like. And she committed suicide. Haile Selassie I and Empress Menen from Ethiopia. Isis and Horus, I said in her room.
Can I see the Haile Selassie again?
Say what?
Can I see the picture of Haile Selassie and his wife again?
Why not? When they were very young. Rare photograph. If you want to contact me, you can do so on Facebook. I got a Facebook fan page. I got over 5,000 members of the Facebook page, 2,000 members of the fan book page. You can also write me at renoco@yahoo.com. Isis and Horus, and that's where we started. Now, I only have about another 1,000 of these to go. So tonight, I hope it just whetted your appetite. We have the greatest story that's barely been told. You can't tell it just in February. You can't tell it just in March. But at least we can initiate the discussion. So I think that we've had a short time, but a very, very good evening. And I hope that these become talking points for you. I hope they renew and elevate your respect for our sisters, our mothers, our daughters, our wives, because there's nothing on earth as wonderful, as beautiful as a black woman. So God bless you all. By saying I express my dilemma as to what defines greatness. And I guess we could have a discussion if time permitted. I guess tonight perhaps is not the time, about what constitutes greatness. Initially, when I started doing these presentations, I talked about the outstanding queens of the Nile Valley and people like Ann and Zynga. And of course, there was Harriet Tubman and Sojourner Truth and Ida B. Wells and Rosa Parks and others. But I don't know. Today, for the first time, I thought to myself, my mother was a great woman. My mother was a nurse's aide. And sometimes she worked cleaning up folks' houses because that was the only way we could survive. And she got up sometimes, most of the time, before dark or before light, worked her butt off, and came home to feed her children. Never complained. And I think she's as great as an ancient Egyptian queen. I think that sisters who do what they have to do to keep the family together, you know, whose names will never be mentioned in a book, there'll never be a play about them, there'll never be a documentary about them, I think are equally great. And I know we have some great women in this room today. So let's see if we can have a bit of a discussion. Perhaps there are some questions or brief comments, and if you keep your questions brief, I'll try to keep my comments brief so we can prolong the discussion as long as we can, because we do have limited access to this room. Does anybody have a question or comment? Let's start way in the back and work our way forward. A brother in the red.
Those statues? Not those statues, but you see statues of figures in Switzerland and so on and so forth. What material was those made out of? Was that stone? What was that?
The ones I showed from Switzerland, they're carved from wood. And they're painted black. And from time to time, people have tried to paint them white. And the people in the church just have a fit. Because the blackness is equated with miracle working ability. So blackness is mystic, and it evokes, I guess, power and majesty. But the ones I showed, the one I showed from Switzerland, they're made of wood. Brother, I saw your hand. Yeah.
What would you advise for a young historian starting out as far as how to go about research or whatnot?
My advice would be, because I was a young historian starting out at some point, read everything you get your hands on. At some point, begin to find something that you feel particularly drawn to and focus on that. Develop a degree of expertise or authority in a subject that's very, very important and that has not had the kind of research that it deserves to have. Go to as many of these lectures as you can. Ask twice as many questions. In other words, let's say, ask a lot of questions. Have the motto that the only bad question is the one that you don't ask and think about later and say, I should have asked. And listen twice as much as you talk. One of the problems I have with young people is they know everything. They got an answer for every question. And as you get older, you learn, you become more humble. And you realize that it's okay not to have all the answers. Or perhaps it's more important to know the most important questions to ask. And the last thing I would say is stay in touch with me. Send me some emails. Let's stay connected. Because I'm looking for young people to pass this along to. I'm 55 years of age now, okay? And I can see the end of the tunnel. I didn't say 55 years old now. I said 55 years of age. But I can also see the end of the tunnel. I'm getting a little tired now. And I know that, I never saw a bus full of books in a funeral procession. You know, that we have to have an intergenerational transmission of wisdom. And a good teacher, it seems to me, should be trying to develop good students who are going to take this to other levels. So that's my advice. Let's have a question from a sister or a comment from a sister.
Back to what you were saying about Australia, like I never knew that. Like,
speak up a little bit, sis.
Back to what you were saying about Australia, about black people not being considered human until 1967.
Yeah.
Where would I be able to find more information about
that? Oh, anywhere.
I never, what was their basis of them not being able?
Well, Australia was settled, invaded by the British officially. Well, I'll say this. In January 1788, a fleet of ships landed in Botany Bay in Sydney Harbor in New South Wales, Australia. And that part of Australia, New South Wales, was established as a British penal settlement, a penal colony. And then it went from New South Wales to Victoria to Queensland, Tasmania. And they never recognized there were humans in that area. They never signed a treaty with the people, and they nearly exterminated Aboriginal Australians. They stole their children. That's called the Stolen Generation. So, I mean, it's common knowledge. It's not a big deal. If you go, I guess, to the maybe the Australian Constitution.
And, that's not something I've ever heard in my life.
Oh, it's common knowledge.
Yeah, but I guess they're not going to teach you that at all.
Yeah, I mean, everybody knows that in Australia. Aboriginals readily acknowledge that, so that's not new news. It was not a crime to kill a black person because they weren't considered humans, no more than it would be a crime to step on a roach. Yeah, brother?
Professor, I was going to suggest to you, I got two things. One, I was going to suggest to you, there's a movie that was written that came out 3 years ago called Rabbit Proof Facts.
Powerful film.
It was a powerful film, and it talked about that slavery didn't end in Australia until 1978. So those people don't know that, but I would suggest you see Rabbit Proof Facts if you get it on Netflix. What I was going to ask you, Professor, was very quickly, can you speak to, along those lines, can you speak to the quality of life that black people, like, you know, I don't think of, I'm going to Turkey soon, and I don't think of black people in Turkey, or like when you go to Rome, you don't expect to see too many there. Can you speak to the quality of life that everyone that you interact with, what is the life like for black folks in those countries?
I'm
looking.
Is it
like here?
It is like it is here. In the sense that black people on the bottom of the social ladder. I think that it was interesting. You know, I love Barack Obama. I love Michelle, the family. And I was very excited when he was elected. And a lot of people were talking about, because I didn't believe it was going to happen. I knew they were going to do a recount, something. And people were talking about the post-racial America. That now, everything is going to be cool. But nothing has changed. Ask Henry Louis Gates if things have changed. So wherever I go, with few exceptions, I find black people at the bottom of the social ladder. And yet, most of the people in Turkey will tell you that there's no race, we're all the same. You know, the people that took me to meet those black folk were saying, everybody's the same in Turkey, but when you talk to the people, you realize it's very different. They tell you themselves, we're discriminated against, there's racism directed against us, and it's like that everywhere. You go to Pakistan, you go to India, Brazil, Peru, Ecuador, Bolivia, wherever I found black folk, they're at the bottom. Turkey is no exception to that. I went to Turkey three times between 2004 and 2005, a period of 18 months I went there, and I found that there are 3.5 million people of African descent. There's a brother in Turkey who is actually from Kenya who's done a book about it, but unfortunately the book is written in Turkish. But I had somebody translate portions of it, and he claims that 3.5 million people of African descent in Turkey, and they live in the southwest part of Turkey near Izmir. Who's next?
And if I could just... I wanted to piggyback on something you said to her. She's my niece, so I want her to get a full picture of how the history actually played out. The thing with the Australians being considered with
flora and fauna.
Right. That's a Victorian, well, actually it comes out of Greece, because the people who are enslaved in Greece were called man-footed things. So you weren't given any kind of human attribution. And the Victorian age took on that type of hierarchical system as well. First came God, then came the king, then came the queens, then came the so-called nobles, then came the business people, then came the farmers, then came women in terms of a hierarchical position, then came the fauna, flora, and slaves, and minerals. So that was just the uniform policy.
Now, the black people in Australia were never thought of as slaves.
No, but they were considered man-footed things. They were in the same classification as Africans, wherever, actually not only African, indigenous people, wherever these this particular culture went, they took on the same type of attitude toward the indigenous population.
Pardon me, before we go on to the next, this is that good time that we all know and love. Welcome to church. So as we have on the fly suggested donation, I like to do it at the end because now you can judge with your heart what it is that you feel as though you should give. Was the information valid for you? Was it presented in a lively and engaging manner? I think we can all agree that you got some top quality information here and delivered by a brother who was able to convey some very high thoughts in a very down-to-earth manner that everybody can understand. And I only wish we had more people here, more youth, particularly more sisters to see these images of themselves, and particularly more brothers to see these images of sisters who are not in bathing suits and such. So I'm gonna pass this around, and everybody can just kind of handle it yourself, and well, I'm gonna start here, and then that way it can come back up to the front, and just pass that around. Thank you.
Now, this is an opportunity to show how you value this. If you don't value it, don't give anything. But don't walk away from here thinking that liberation doesn't cost anything. I had to take a train out of that place instead. If you don't value it, don't give anything.
And I just heard today the tickets to see Maxwell and Jill Scott are $247.
Could you, the most recent, the Independent African Nation celebrates its 35th year this year of Cape Verde, and which is sort of central to American history, especially the slave trade, because there were over 28,000 slaves who came through Cape Verde to the Americas.
I tried to get to Cape Verde about 2 years ago, and I was not able to get beyond Lisbon. I just couldn't work it out. I know that it has a rich history. There are a lot of African people of Cape Verdean origin in Portugal, and I know there's a large Cape Verdean community here. But I don't know a lot about the history of Cape Verde.
Cape Verde. So you can get there from Boston, direct. But as far as, because African women who are the ones who really populated most of Cape Verde, and they're the ones who brought the African culture to Cape Verde. So when you talk about, I know there's a big sort of a kind of a discussion about the differences between Cape Verdeans and African Americans, but really there is no difference.
All right.
When you look at it.
Well, I appreciate those comments. I would love to do more research on the subject.
I'd gladly talk to you about it.
All right, sounds good. Let's hear from another sister. Way in the back.
First, I would like to say that this, for me, came right on time. So I really appreciate your work, and I'm just going to show that.
Thank you.
But I had two questions. One was just in reference to the woman you mentioned who funded John Brown's rage.
Mary Ellen Pleasant. Sometimes she's called Mammy Pleasant, okay. Mary Pleasant. Now, one of the things I like about her and a lot of the people I showed is because they contradict a criticism that I have of our people. If I have a criticism of black folk, is that in general, we tend to think somebody else is going to do it. And you don't have to do anything. That maybe you might want to pray or meditate, and one morning you're going to wake up and you'll be free. That George Clooney is going to do it, that Angelina Jolie is going to, but I don't have to do it. And I know there are people like that in this room tonight who feel like it's not incumbent upon me. And that's why we're in the situation that we're in. In order to be liberated, you have to look at yourself in the mirror and say, what is my responsibility towards that liberation? Now, Mary Ellen Pleasant stepped up to the plate. And if more of us would do that, we wouldn't be in the situation that we're in. So I think that she is a wonderful role model, and yet she died in obscurity. I think she died in San Francisco. So her name is Mary Ellen Pleasant. There are biographies about her, and she was a businesswoman.
My second question is, in 2008, I was afforded the opportunity to travel to Ghana to study abroad. I was in Ghana and in Ghana, I found that they were, you know, a lot more receptive to African Americans than Tanzania, but there was a common understanding of the history of African America, of black people in America. But it seemed that they were frustrated about the lack of black Americans that come to visit Africa or that, you know, come there. But it was also this understanding from the people who I spoke to that we were doing so much better in America, and that and I didn't really know how to respond. So I guess my question is, how can we as a people become more aware of, I guess, what Cora's question was about, you know, one, our common history, and two, like the current state of how we fare around the world, you know?
Sit down and talk to one another. I've always been told that in relationships, and I'm an expert on messing up relationships. So I know what not to do. And sisters have always told me, Renoko, the most important thing in any relationship is communication. And we don't talk to each other enough. I firmly believe that. And as a result of that, we have all kind of misperceptions and misunderstandings about one another. For example, in Ghana, there's a term that's used, and that term is Obruni. And Obruni is, I don't know if it's Twi or what language it is, but it has connotations of wicked and foreign and white. And it's not unusual for African Americans to be called Obrunis. There's a similar name in Uganda, a country I love called Mzungu. And these are names that are usually referred to, that are reserved for white people. Because most of us act like white people when we go to Africa. We take the same sets of values that Europeans have when we go to Africa. We walk like them, we talk like them, we have an innate sense of superiority. Speaking generally, because we come from such a powerful country. It happens to me. And nobody loves Africa more than I do. But you realize when you're in Africa and other parts of the world how deeply ingrained the American experience is in you. And it comes out. I've been with groups of people in Africa, African Americans in Ghana, who I've heard go out of their way to say loud, these people stink. Because people don't have money for deodorant. And they make it a point to make sure that the Ghanaians hear that. Now, I think it's almost ingrained in us that if you have more than other people, this is Victorian, I don't know, that if you have more than other people, you are better than other people. Okay. And then a lot of Africans on the continent tend to have a condescending view of African Americans because they see us as the descendants of slaves. They see the things on TV, so you hoes and you bitches and you drug addicts and you criminals, that's their perception. They're told stay away from us, excuse my blunt language, but we need to be real sometimes. And so my thing is, we just need to sit and talk to one another with love and tolerance and respect and patience. And that's not always a thing to do. That's not always an easy thing to do. So that's my, and go to Africa. But go with the right kind of mindset. I've been to half the countries in Africa. I love to go to all of them. I've been invited for the first time to Nigeria, the Kino 2 conferences. This is the 50th year of Nigerian independence. And Nigeria is a place where it's no joke. Well, you don't just go, you don't just get on a plane and go. You need to have boots on the ground. But I'm gonna go and have that experience. I think Neil and I were a part of a discussion a little while ago, a few years ago, that E-Group I moderated, called the Global African Presence. And that was, who are the most arrogant Africans in the world? Was it African Americans, was it Jamaicans, or what? But I just think we need to sit and talk to one another. Africans on the continent will sometimes tell you you're not an African, you're an American. And I resent that. But for every African on the continent of Africa who tell me I'm not an African, I bet I can find 100,000 African-Americans who say I'm not an African. I ain't no African. The African booty scratchers, they come from the jungle. They're not civilized. They stink. They eat bad. And then people say, I don't want to deal with Africa because your ancestors sold my ancestors into slavery. These kinds of myths and misperceptions destroy our ability to rise up. So go there, see it, be humble, talk to people. Those are my suggestions. Who is Neil? Go for it.
I really appreciated the pictures of the women from India. And I know you traveled to India in the past, but I was wondering if you could, if you could talk about sort of the current state of things in India in terms of black consciousness there.
Well, it's growing. India, you have different issues. Just like here, you have race, you have class, you have gender, probably other things that don't even come to mind. In India, you have race, you have class, you have gender, you have caste. And they all intersect one another. Like some people would say, there are no black people in India. Or that, you know, we're all the same. So it's very complex. You have the people called the Dravidians, and other tribal people who to me are an ethnic social group or an ethnic linguistic group. And then you have the Untouchables or Dalits who are a social economic group. So it's very complex, Neil. You have organizations historically like the Dalit Panthers who named themselves after the Black Panther Party. In many parts of India, I'm really a celebrated figure. And that's maybe why the government of India has told me that if I ever come back to India, they have something for me over there, okay? Because they don't want African Americans going over there stirring up their Negros. You remember in the early 1960s in the Civil Rights Movement, people in Mississippi and Alabama were saying, our Negros was fine until you Northern agitators came down and gave them these ideas about freedom. They were doing just great. Well, I think that's the attitude of the Indian government, and they don't want the bond between African Americans and black folk in India. I think Australia may be very similar to that. Like the greatest thing, I mean, African unity means African power. African power means the death of white supremacy. And so naturally, these governments will go out of their way to suppress that. Who's got the next question? Yes.
I wanted to ask you a question on philosophy, since you dictated what your philosophy of history was,
yes.
What you do, based on what you think, what you know, and what you've been told. I want to ask the philosopher Stone question of how do you answer the question, the three questions, who am I, who is my creator, and what's my purpose?
I don't know what that has to do with the topic tonight.
I asked it to say because I have a radio program whenever I would have Naeem Akbar on there, someone that's into, you know, we know you're a historian. I'm asking for those of us that are coming up with our own philosophy. If you're asked this question, how much have you given thought to it?
What are the three questions you're asking?
How do you answer the question, who am I?
I'm an African.
I mean, who is my creator?
I'd say nature.
Mm. And what is my purpose?
And God is nature. My nature is to liberate African people and help make the world a better place. That's for me. Yes. Yes. Sister, I'll get you next. I didn't see you here. Yes.
What do you think of the historical... What are some of the historical mistakes as far as history is concerned?
I think that there's a lot of mistakes that we make. One is, today, we expect other people to liberate us. That's very obvious to me. Another mistake is we want to develop a race-first philosophy. And more often than not, we love the world more than we love ourselves. That we are embarrassed about alienating other people. We want to make the world happy. We're quick to forgive. I give you an example. A few years ago, I did a lecture in St. Vincent in the Caribbean. There was a beautiful couple sitting in front of me, a black couple, and I really liked them. And after the lecture was, after the Q&A, they said, have you forgiven Europeans for their role in enslavement? And I said, well, most of them haven't asked for forgiveness. And their response was, do they need to ask? Now, that degree of humanity, that we're all one people, can we, as Rodney King said, you know Rodney King? The brother who was nearly beaten to death in Los Angeles when he finally did a press interview. The immortal words, can we all just get along? And I think that that is one of the blessings and curses of African people. That we will not, we are reluctant to develop a philosophy that says we gonna get our community together before anything else. Before we worry about the world loving us, we're gonna make sure that our community is strong. People will not go for that. If I say a black man and a black woman will be together, inevitably somebody will tell you love is colorblind and it doesn't matter. Why should I live in the black community? Why should I send my children to a black school? I'm just a human being after all. Now, on the surface, that's wonderful, but it flies in the face of reality. I think that maybe that's our biggest downfall, our biggest weakness. We love other people more than we love ourselves. We're not selfish enough. We will not develop a race, what Marcus Garvey called a race-first philosophy. And I'm a strong advocate of that. That's how we got in trouble in the first place, by letting other people in the house. They took the house, raped your wife, took over, and made you an outsider, took your history away from you. And yet we are still quick to love the world. And I'm not like that. I don't hate anybody, but I love black folk first. And that's my guiding light. And I don't care if you don't like it. That upsets you. That's too bad. Because other people do those things instinctively. But us, we have to be drilled into that. Because we love the world, and the world don't love us. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I said the sister, yeah.
Okay. I wanted to really thank you, because I think these are just majestic images. And I was drawn to... I was drawn to the image of the sister who had her hand on her hip, the soul sister.
From Pakistan.
Yeah, from Pakistan. And I think one of the things that I wrestled with personally is the images of black women in media are come from a place of being defined as hoes or being defined as sexual beings only, but there's so much more to that. And I think especially in black men, having, it's rare to see someone really celebrate the core of who we are. My question is, what sort of looking at the modern day representations of the media, you know, and what those archetypes are as it emerges from the mulatto and Sambo and all of those things, sort of where do you see the role of us sort of emancipating from that? Like, talk about the community and building from there, but what also in your legacy of leaving things behind, where do you see our ability to sort of gain back our image in the media coming from? Do you see actors who are doing that?
Very few, there's some.
That's right.
I admire Danny Glover a great deal. I feel sorry for black actors and actresses. Some of them will do anything. Mm-hmm. They'll take any role. Mm-hmm. A lot of times I don't even go to the movies to see black films. I never saw Precious. I'm tired of seeing, you know, the stereotypical black woman who's big and fat and ugly, you know, who was abused by her father. I'm tired of that. I've seen enough of that. I want to see a positive image. I'm tired of seeing black people as athletes whose fathers abandoned them. I'm tired of that. But it's difficult to get out of that. You know, the rap music, some of the stuff, my God. You know, I mean, look at the images that we see. So I see some exceptions to that, but I don't see nearly enough. And it just seems to me that we are prepared, most of us, we are conditioned to be anti-African. We are conditioned to be anti-black. And we act in an anti-black or anti-African manner almost instinctively. And it's not just African Americans, it's not just Africans in the Caribbean and South America, but it's Africans on the continent as well. So I suppose what keeps me from going completely insane, because I'm about halfway there, but what keeps me from going all the way out is realizing that the situation that we're in didn't just start yesterday. And it's not going to end tomorrow. It's going to take a lot of work. Now, take lessons from old African activists. I've been in the movement since I was 18 years old. And there are some lessons that I learned that weren't in the book. One, no matter how hard you work, you can't do it by yourself. It requires organization. You may not get along with the next person, because that brother stole your girlfriend in high school 40 years ago. You've been mad ever since. You can't get along with that person, right? Another lesson, no matter how hard you work, no matter what you do, you're not gonna change the situation overnight. I think sometimes we young people, you want change so quickly that if you don't get change, if you don't see those immediate results, you get frustrated and you throw up your hands and you become a part of the problem. So it takes time, it takes discussion, it takes sacrifice, it takes bloodshed, it takes hard work. So until we're prepared to do those kinds of things, I think we're going to stay in the situation that we're in. I don't have a silver bullet. I don't have a quick answer for that. Somebody who has not asked a question or made a comment. Yeah.
So my question was about ancient...
And these are just my opinions. This is just what I think. Yeah.
And ancient black civilizations, and I say ancient because I like to get at the core. I try to think of travel as far back as possible for what I feel like is a more original understanding. Like, what was the status of women? Like, how were they valued? What was their role in society, et cetera?
Women in ancient times, especially Africans, and let's say in the African world, from what I could gather, were exalted. I think that God was first identified in a feminine form. That's what I think. In ancient Egypt, the line of descent was traced to the female side of the family. The worst thing you could do in ancient Egypt was to disrespect your mother. You know, so the mother had an exalted position. In ancient Egypt, women could will and inherit fortunes. They could bring suits to the courts of law. Some women achieved the status of pharaoh. You don't find that, at least I've not found that, in Greco-Roman society. So in ancient Africa, the woman was extremely important. Highly respected. And I think that we've gotten away from a lot of that. That in America, we have taken on, a lot of us, a strong patriarchal value system. Well, we do see sisters as sexual objects or objects that we can exploit. And I don't think that's the African way. Next. Brother, I want to get to somebody who's not asked a question because we only have a few more minutes. Anybody else? All right, in the back. And then we'll come back to you. Yeah.
Knowledge set into like all the institutions. Like
you tell me, how do we do it?
In the school system?
How do we do it?
Well, okay, wait a minute. Because the reason why I'm asking this, like close to 20 years ago, I sat through a lecture with Ivan Van Sertima.
The great Ivan Van Sertima.
And he said it takes 20 years for like new scholarship to get integrated into, I'm just saying, that's what he said. So going on 20 years, where it's still on the pre-Columbus, so on the pre-Columbus on research and so forth, and maybe like 3 years ago I saw on National Geographic about blacks in Egypt, black pharaohs in Egypt. So I'm just saying, like, from your perspective, have you seen a subtle integration of of like black academic, black scholarship along the lines of Ivan Van Sermon?
Not to any significant extent. I knew Ivan. I consider myself Ivan's number one student. I met Ivan in 1981. We worked till he died. All the journals that Ivan produced, with two exceptions, I contributed to, helped edit. But I never agreed with Ivan on that. Ivan always thought, we talked about this many times, that if you presented a compelling enough case, if you were able to show this many points of reference or documentation, this degree of data, to support the African presence in pre-Columbian America, what he called his thesis, then academia would eventually give way. I always thought Ivan was incredibly naive in that regard, and I never agreed with that. I think that major components of this society, no matter what you say, no matter how hard you dig, no matter what research you do, they're never going to relent. Ivan is not the first person. In 1974, there was a conference in Cairo sponsored by UNESCO, and many great Egyptologists were invited, including the greatest of them all to me, Sheikh Andrew Joker. And he listed point after point after point to show how we know the ancient Egyptians were black people. One of the delegates jumped up and down and said, even if you can prove the ancient Egyptians were black, they were still white. That's the level that many people operate on. And I bless Ivan's heart, I think putting a 20-year moratorium or saying we're going to do this in 20 years, white folks are going to eventually say, yeah, you're right, let's put this in the curriculum. I think that's incredibly naive. So one of the things that I think we need to do is build our own school system. Yeah, brother.
You're on travel that you are. What's your opinion of changes in black people around the world of the Obama presidency?
They're hopeful. They're optimistic. I think, unfortunately, a lot of that hope and optimism is going to fade, just like it's faded among many of us. I've been in many places, and people see Barack Obama not just as the president of the United States, but as the president of the black world. So it's given people a lot of hope, a lot of possibilities. But I think people also know that it's a system. It's not an individual. And no matter how dynamic and intellectual and dedicated an individual is, it takes a lot to change the system. And I think that reality for many of us has set in. And I'm afraid that that same reality is going to set in on Aboriginal Australians and Pacific Islanders and Ghanaians who love Barack Obama, that it takes more than one gifted black individual to change the world. Yes, sister.
Why do you think that the African culture is one of the main cultures that where the black people are highly exalted? Like, I've heard about Indians and how they don't really respect the women. It's more
I can barely hear you.
I said, why do you think women in the African culture are one of the only cultures where they're highly exalted?
Well, to answer your question, African culture is not monolithic. Africa is made up of 54 countries. Africa is 12 million square miles. In much of Africa, the woman today is nothing. In Islamic Africa, women have very little value. And I think much of Africa has taken on the same kind of Eurocentric patriarchal values that dominate most of the rest of the world. In some African cultures, I mean, the importance of the woman is still very strong, but I think it's hard to speak generally. Now, India was once, let's do this. Humanity began in Africa. Those Africans went out to people the rest of the world. Africans are instrumental in the development of classical civilization. And then there's the enslavement, the colonial period, when the values of Africa come to be subordinate to the values of Europe.